Thank you. and punch each other's heads and guys. We're quite disposed to keep it quiet, provided that they make it right. But if they do not seem to see it, I'll give to us a thank you.
blame anything at all on me chancy lease, eh? Hey, cos it's time to rush there, isn't it, madam? We'll go to that market. It's around here somewhere.
Oh, no, not the market. Hey, look at this.
Thank you.
learned a thing or two. Cause up to then I didn't have an idea of what the modern world was coming to. I counted 20 gas buckets going by the cell. Almost every time I took a walk. Then I put my ear to a bell telephone. And a strange woman started into talk. Kansas.
money. It's not the Wells Fargo wagon. They've only the horse and put it in a livery stable.
Great damnation, is it? They're bringing the wagon over here.
Gee, have you noticed? There's more people sitting in the shade than standing in the sunlight.
Well, there sure is. But that's because the sun affects the head.
Well, he certainly got the point.
Who's that?
It's Eddie.
Shall we give him some potion?
Well, we'd better not, because it'll go straight to his head.
Oh. Actually, folks, it's your lucky day today, because we're here to sell you some potion. Now, this potion is mighty strong. It cures everything from ingrown toenails
to outgrowing toenails,
from headache
to healing,
from dawn
to dusk.
In fact, this potion is so good. My wife was very, very nervous. She was as nervous as a long-tailed cat in a room full of rocking chairs. She was so nervous, I couldn't even sleep with her. But after only one bottle of this potion,
anybody can sleep with her.
In actual fact, this is the elixir of life. Well, my grandpapa, he died aged 109. He fell out of the saddle at the Pony Express delivering the mail. And my grandma, well, she died aged 112. But the good news is, the baby lived.
In fact, there's only one thing that this potion will not cure.
What's that?
Baldness.
Well, do you know, I never knew that. Okay, well, it's your lucky day because we're going to sell you some potion. But first, we're going to demonstrate just how powerful this potion is. Can you ask around?
Has anybody got a headache? You got a headache?
No, no.
Have you got a headache?
No.
Have you got a headache?
Well, I've got a little headache.
Well, that's because you've only got a little head. Will you step forward here? Is there anything that this lady can sit on over there? Can you sit down here with the boot over here?
Now, have you ever stood for a knife throw before?
No.
Well, ain't that just a coincidence, because I've never thrown knives before. No, in actual fact, you got a little headache, and we're going to make it disappear. Just place the box on the head. The head goes in the box like that. Are you comfortable? Right, just place that down the back. And now place this one down the front. Now then, if we just get the large sword, then we're going to put the large sword right through the wound. Right through the front of your head, like that. That'll just stop it chattering. Now then, we're going to take two swords. I'm going to stick this through here. And then we're going to stick this one through the back.
There's another sword.
Another sword. Can you fix one in that side?
I'll stick this sword here.
And this one goes through here. Some more swords. This.
Get some more swords.
And then we're going to get a little bit of potion, and we're going to show you how powerful this potion is.
Okay.
they give her a sprinkle of the potion. Well, then the magic potion goes on a lot. And now we'll see if the headache's gone. Not only is the headache gone, now just remove all the swords. All the swords are removed. Are you alright, Mum? Are you okay in there? And now you've all seen just how powerful this potion is. We're going to sell it to you.
Okay, who's the first person who wants this potion? This is the actual potion we just used here. There you go, sir. There's another one. You want one there, sir? Okay. Anybody else here? There you go. Anybody else? Here you go. Here you go.
Thank you. Now look, let's give them some more magic and sell them some better potion, because I kind of like these people. Just show that the bag's empty.
Okay. Well, we've got a bag here. It opens at the bottom. And as you can see, put my hand through it, there's nothing in the bag. Put that back and zip it back up again. So there you go, you've got your empty bag.
I've got an empty bag and you've got a $2
bill. Well, I think you've got a $2 bill here.
We have a green $2 bill. We've got a $2 bill inside the bag. And now,
okay,
we've got to sprinkle a little bit of potion on this bag.
Now, just to prove that this potion works, can we borrow somebody's potion? This is the actual potion we've sold. Put a little bit in there.
There we are. The potion's gone in the bag. Would you pull your sleeve up and take out the $2 bill?
I'll take out the $2 bill. I'll turn the bag inside out. You can see the only thing, it's a $5 bill.
So the $2 bill has turned into a $5 bill with the potion. And we're going to do that for you. Anyone that's got $2, pass me to my accomplice. And we'll welcome you back.
Here you go.
Just remember how many girls you put in the bag, because we're going to multiply it for you. Okay, let's hope
there you go.
For the girls. Thank you kindly. Thank you, Mum. Right, I'm going to put the potion up there now. Okay.
The only thing is, this potion is so powerful,
you're right,
that you better all close your eyes.
You're right.
Yeah. Sorry about that, but keep your eyes closed, and when you open your eyes, you'll all be so wealthy. Okay? Eyes closed now.
The focus should be searched for in the camera. dramatic piece takes place in a little frontier town called Fate. Rip-roaring, root-tooting, wild, lawless kind of a place. Rather like Pink Day around bingo night. But though they had little respect for law and order in those parts, yet they had their own ideas of what a man could do and what a man could not do. Never shoot a man in the back, never kick a man when he's down, and never, never draw on an unarmed man. These ethical principles are about to be exhaustively explored in this piece you are about to witness, entitled The Code of the West. In the fall of 88, in a town called Fate, a day's ride from the Rio Grande, some cowboys were a-hooting and gambling and shooting and drinking strong liquor and shouting. Yes, the West there was wild, no place for a child, only man who for 10 cents would shoot you, and women like them who could sing like a bell. In the Rockford Saloon, she would dance, she would croon. Then many the man that pursued. They shout, and they'd offer the dog. And their comments got louder and louder. Yes, those garments were mean, but their hands remained clean of foul murder and raping the women. Because of me, Boss Kincaid, they was all not afraid, and he didn't admire such sin. His young foreman, Jack Pitt, was a man so great, with his fist the man knew he was meant. In the sound of weeks, they'd all split their dreams, and with most of them saw Jack the man. But Jack Pitt, he was love. Yes, Jack Pitt was tough. He walked tall and was tougher than any. But the thing he knew best was the code of the West. And you know, he gets done, Miss Jack. She was maidenly pure and poisoned in your. Not like that. Now, but long for the arms of Jack, who'd no chance to be living. Now, the mayor of Fate was a man filled with hate, whose love and desire they were met. His ambition, no less, was to one day possess King Kate's cap and rank and Miss Jack. How he coveted that land. And Miss Jenny's wife, eh? So he hired Big Dick, a good fighter. He could draw in a flash. He could draw in a flash. And might have a slash with his knife at your face. What a fight. His faith is broke. And a mayor had found him in Tucson, where in a back bar he caused a fracas by pleasuring a gal with his boots. Now Dick had known him, but not very well. We had peace when he heard the horn. Now he'd shoot in the back, Boss Kincaid and young Jack, have a beer and then next. That old. He long hardened his breast to the code of the West, and now struck with a conscience she's dead from. From the clutches of fate, she just couldn't wait. So she said she helped Dick with his weapon. In the Rockford Saloon, Dick hit the spittoon. He was wild as a vengeful gorilla. Thirsty, small, just like and weak to bear. My horse, you can see, has been hungry all day. He wants his oats now. And so do I. He puckered his lips, ran his hands round her hips. As he seized her, she shuddered with dread. She was tasting that peach when a cold voice cried, "Reach your gout! Let her go! Or taste the lead!" Yes, it was Jack the Neger, the fairest king came. But as he threw a bead on Dick's hide, "I'm unarmed," cried Big Dick, as he waved his hands quick. It was true, just for once he'd not lied. But Jack passed the test of the code of the web. One man must have rules to survive. The claw his gun fell, then yelled, "Okay, now slip me my Colt 45. What dastardly treachery, not to mention what meant to me. Custick's gun was concealed in Nell's gusset. But now the time came for him to reclaim his gun. Nell just wouldn't discuss it. He called Jack, to which one should she give up the gun? For the other would sure bite the dust. Then shot fill the air from the bed on the stage. And Nell dropped the blood with a slug in her closet. Next Jack would have died but for King Gate outside, who prevented Jack's early demise by drawing his pistol and sending a new pistol of 22,000 size through the bird broadly head. Down he fell, slightly dead. T'was for Nell that expressed it, although they had guessed it. But she cried as she sank to her rest. "I deserve now to croak, 'cause I went and broke the immortal code of the way."
Seldom is heard its origin word, and the skies are not cloudy all day. tearjerker. Don't you go making a lot of blubbering noise so you can't hear what we're singing. This is called The Banks of the Old Pine for you.
And only say that you'll be mine, and in the
Oh,
Imperial Cancer Research Fund, of which I am the Audit Committee Chairman of the Buxton and Matlock District. And I have a few thanks to make tonight. My first thank is to you for coming along and supporting us. My second thank is to the cast, to all the people in the back room, the unsung heroes who have done a lot of work. Thank you very much. Going to round you up. I'd like to call on our administration officer, who is actually our secretary, who hates to come on. And she's going to present a bouquet to our producer, Connie Fox.
I want to take this opportunity to miss two people, to miss two people, to include two people who didn't miss. I included them in the general run last time. I shouldn't have. All the dresses, the countdown dresses, everything you see has been made by our Nigel Jennings and Iris. And there's no fiddle. think that's everything now, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. And good night.